Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to have you pray, Rachel. Kora barabashi. Reke bato kota bashi kete bato.
Father God, we consecrate this corporate time of worship to you, Lord. We seek your face. We call your Spirit's presence to come and join us this evening. That as we lift our hearts in praise to you, Lord, that you come down and meet us. I thank you for the prophetic words that will be given tonight. I thank you for the captives that will be set free tonight. I thank you that your presence met us here as we walked through the door and we knew that we were on hallowed ground. And so, Lord, we just seek to dust, to shake the dust of the world off our feet in your presence tonight. That we recognize this moment to come together in corporate worship. That you call us to come together in corporate worship. We thank you for the leadership of this house. We thank you for the leadership of this ministry and ask your blessing upon them and their family. And Lord, just meet each of us that we have an individual experience with you tonight.
Yes.
And that those that may not know you but are here tonight will come to know you through your son, Jesus. Yes. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you so much, Holy Spirit, for being right here in the room with us. And I'm going to also pray just before worship and just consecrate this, my hands to the Lord. So, Lord, I consecrate my hands right now, my voice, and all of us. If you would, put your hands in the air. Lord, we consecrate our hands. The Bible says, who can dwell with everlasting burning? He who has clean hands. So, Lord, we thank you right now for purifying our hands. That is the things that we have done and the things that we do. Thank you for purifying them, setting straight paths for our feet. And Lord, we just want to praise and worship you. We thank you for the revival that you brought into our hearts, God, the revival that's erupting all over the country, Lord. The revival is not an event, Lord. It is a person, and that person lives within us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we welcome you, revival. We welcome you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And we worship you with everything that we are, everything that we have. May the songs that we sing and the attitude, our heart attitudes, be pleasing to you. Whether or not it's sensational, whether or not it's full of outward manifestations, we pray that our inside would be pure like gold, like silver refined in the fire. Hallelujah. I don't have this song planned, but I'm going to start with Sanctuary because this song is about the revival inside. That he has made us pure and holy and acceptable to him by his blood. And now we present ourselves back to him and offer ourselves as his sanctuary. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy. Tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Let's take it up a key. And Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. sanctuary for you. A sanctuary for you. And I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul. Rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound. Let it be. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ears. Let's sing that one more time. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul. Rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound. One more time, let it be. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ears. In Jesus. In Jesus. And holy and anointed one, Jesus. Listen again, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Holy and anointed one, Jesus, your name is like honey on my lips, your spirit like water to my soul, your word is a lamp unto my feet. Jesus, I love you, I love you, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, risen, risen and exalted one, Jesus. Do that one more time, Jesus, Jesus. Give him your love, Jesus. Risen and exalted one, Jesus. Precious Jesus, oh, precious Jesus, we worship you, oh Lord. Oh, Lord, we worship you. We give you the glory. We give you the honor tonight. And that's due your name. That's due your name. Oh, Jesus. most holy. Holy and anointed one, Jesus, Jesus. One more time, Jesus, 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 risen and exalted, risen and exalted one, Jesus, with just the vocals. Your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit's like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Jesus, I love you. I love you. Jesus, you love me. Jesus, you love me. You love me. One more time. Jesus, you love me. Jesus, you love me. You love me. And we thank you for your love. It's fallen down around us. It's enfolding us. Oh, we're surrounded by your love. It's comforting our hearts. Oh, it's healing our bodies. It's enveloping us with strength. Oh, for the battle. And it's washing away our fear as we present ourselves before you. We worship your holy name. Oh, Lord Jesus.
Let's stand. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus, holy, holy and anointed one, Jesus, risen, risen and exalted one, Jesus.
Hallelujah. There are two angels here. I asked the Lord what they were. There's an angel for healing. There's an angel for deliverance. God, you're free to interrupt this service with whatever you want to do. He showed me specifically for Ray. Is Ray still in the building? Is Ray in the back? Downstairs. Sarah, can you check outside? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He was showing me a vision for Ray. The Lord is wanting to set the captives free. Hallelujah. Rabashara handu kukayati. Let faith arise in the room.
Yes.
Let's continue to just speak his name, sing his name, Jesus.
Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, oh,
I want to pray for you.
Exalted one.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
It'll be be off camera, so don't worry. The camera is focused on Leo. Everybody focus on Jesus.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, your life to us. Your life to us, Jesus. Your life to our heart, our mind, our soul. Oh, you provide us strength. Your hope to our hearts. Your hope to
Lord,
our
was showing
minds.
Me the curvature of your spine has been bent by the devil.
Hallelujah.
And the Lord's going to heal you. And he's wanting to set you free Hallelujah. From not just nightmares, but trouble sleeping at night. Is that something
Jesus.
You want? Okay, now you want to give me your hand? Let's extend our hands towards Ray. If you have your prayer language, just begin to pray in the Spirit. If not, just speak the name above all names. Jesus. Ray, raise your other hand. Just like that. I want you to say something for me. Can you do that? Say Jesus.
Jesus.
Heal me.
Heal me.
Touch me.
Touch me.
Set me free.
Help me to know you.
Help me to know you. I like that necklace. I'm just noticing that.
Jesus.
There's two big old angels here.
Oh, Jesus.
One is for healing and one is for deliverance.
Oh, Jesus.
Rabashi.
Oh, Jesus.
Don't be scared. Keep that hand raised. You're not on camera.
Oh, Jesus.
Keep your hand just like that.
Open
this hand up.
Oh, Jesus. Name above all names.
We break the power of the enemy
Jesus.
Right now.
Oh, Jesus.
Right now. In the name of Jesus. God, we thank you for setting the captives free tonight.
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus. Setting the captives free tonight.
Jesus.
We speak deliverance
Jesus.
From every lying spirit. Every lying spirit right now. We command them to go now in Jesus' name. I plead the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus.
Jesus.
I speak peace right now. Peace right now. Just receive. Just receive. I hear the Lord saying, I'm wanting to establish trust with you. You've been hurt so many times. The Lord has seen it all. I see you just cursing the Lord. If you're real, why would you let this happen? The Lord didn't do all those bad things to you. It's when we believe the devil, we give him access to our lives. He has put on your heart. Because after you said that prayer, accepting him into your life, he's not going to let you go now. He's not going to let you go now. It is time to come out of agreement with the devil. The Lord has so many things he has for you. He has greater love than you could ever even imagine. And I know that's hard to believe because you've been so hurt. I want to make it really simple for you. God is good the devil is bad. It's time to make a choice. Do you want God or do you want the devil? It's not a shrug answer. You have whatever you desire. What do you want? Continue to just lift the name of Jesus.
Yeshua, we speak the name of Jesus. We worship the name of Jesus. We exalt the name of Jesus, our Savior, our friend, our healer, our counselor. We speak the name of Jesus. We speak the name of Jesus. We love the name of Jesus. We have the name of Jesus. Oh, miracle worker, your healer, our Savior. Oh, Jesus, eternal one. Jesus, the name above all names, the King of kings and Lord of lords, the bright and morning star you are. The Lord, you're the master.
Thank you, Lord.
And I saw thee.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
And I exalt
Jesus.
Thee.
We exalt thee.
And I exalt thee, O Lord. And I exalt thee, O Jesus, I exalt thee, and I exalt thee, O Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Father God, we praise you. We worship you. God, we know that salvation is a gift that's freely given, but cannot be forced upon anyone. Father God, we know that deliverance and healing are gifts freely given, but again, cannot be forced upon anyone. Every single one of us has a choice. Every single one of us has free will. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son. He died for us so we could be reestablished into our rightful place in him. He reconnected us to the Father. Through the Son. It's up to us to surrender, to walk in the fullness of his glory. There's nothing special about any man or woman of God other than the level of surrender that they have committed to and allowed the Lord to move through them. To one, he has given the gift of healing. To one, the gift of prophecy. But I'm telling you the truth. we can all walk in all the gifts. As the Spirit wills, when we lay down our lives and walk according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Free will is one of the greatest forms of love. Free will is. God doesn't want robots. He wants us to make a choice, and he wants that choice to be him. We're his kids. He doesn't want anybody to choose the enemy. Satan's lies are nothing but that. They're lies. They are lies. He offers some worldly power that's temporary, some worldly pleasure that's temporary, and none of it will fix the God-sized hole in you. They are lies. They are lies. They are lies. Believe me, I've tried the devil. Didn't work for me. God is so much greater than he's. There's no high like the Most High. There's no euphoria like his presence. I hear the Lord showing me he's got rubies in his hands right now. And he says, I have gifts for you. I have gifts for my people. Hallelujah. Precious.
Hallelujah.
The Lord is saying, you are more precious to me than any gold, than any silver, than any jewel, than any gem. You, I died for you. Receive that now. Just say, God, you died for me. Yes. If I was the only one, you would have done it.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. That's the love of the Father, fully expressed through the Son. Thank you, Jesus. I hear the Lord saying, I have more of my Holy Spirit for those that are surrendered. Empty yourself of yourself and be filled with the Spirit of the living God. He shall withhold no thing from you. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father above of heavenly lights, in whom there is no shadow of turning, no variation, no variable. Hallelujah. I didn't plan on saying any of this tonight. None of this has anything to do with what the Lord has told me to preach on. God, you're free to interrupt. We're just getting out of your way. We were talking earlier. We're going to get out of your way. Whatever it is you want to do, Lord, we surrender to you now. This service is not our service. This service is your service. This ministry, not our ministry. It is your ministry. Let it be a pleasing aroma to you, Lord. Let it be a pleasing aroma. I don't want to get to heaven and be one of the ones that cried, Lord, Lord, didn't I prophesy in your name? And he says, I never knew you. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. No, we want to be walking in repentance. It's synonymous with revival. True revival isn't just worshiping the Lord 24/7. That's part of it. Don't mishear me. It's living a sanctified life. It's having the fruit of the Spirit. It's walking in the gifts of the Spirit. Jesus' words, all who believe shall speak in new tongues. They shall cast out demons. Trample on serpents and scorpions. Those are demons. They'll trample on demons. They shall lay their hands on the sick so they will be healed. Not may be healed, they will be healed. Hallelujah. The Lord told me to train up some people, some tongue-talking, demon-stomping people. Anybody with me on that?
Amen.
walk in humility. Demons bow at the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Even the demons obey us, Jesus, in your name. Walk in humility. Because Jesus saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning. Do not praise. And we're about to get back to the praise. This is a prerequisite to the praise. Hallelujah. Do not rejoice because the demons tremble and the demons obey you. Rejoice because your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. We're going to spend eternity with the Lord, the King of Kings. That's something that's worthy of praise, of exuberant rejoicing. Let's praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Oh, there's a sweet spirit in the room. Jesus. We worship you. All honor. All honor. All glory. All power to
the Lord wants to take over. All honor, all glory, and all power unto you. He's not in a hurry. There's a reason the Bible says to wait. He's not in a hurry.
precious Jesus, our Savior, Holy Spirit, we wait on you, Holy Spirit, we wait on you, Holy Spirit, we wait on you, we wait on you. We wait on you. We give you all the honor, all glory. Give you all the power, 'cause it's all yours. We give you all the honor. We give you all the glory. We give you all the power, 'cause it's all yours. Where you go, we go. What you say, we say, Lord. What you pray, we pray. What you pray, we pray. Where you go? Where you go, we go. What you say, we say, Lord. What you pray, we pray. What you pray, we pray. You would only go where you saw him go. You would only say what you heard him speak. You would only do what you saw him do, following the Spirit. Inside of me, come be the flame within my heart. Come be the fire inside of me until you and I. We are one until you and I are one, completely one. Oh, yeah. Won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. Sing this with me. Won't relent. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. Sing that again. You won't relent. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. I set you as a seal, you as a seal upon my heart, upon my heart. As a seal upon my arm, for many waters cannot quench this love. To you, all honor. The Holy Spirit is exploding. All glory and all power to you. Sing that again. All honor, all honor, and all glory and all power to you. Time, all honor, give him all the honor, all glory and all power to you. Holy Father, we worship you, precious Jesus, my Savior and Holy Spirit, we wait on you, Holy Spirit, we wait on you, and Holy Spirit. Oh, we wait on you. Come do what you want to do. Come do what you want to do. I will make room for you. Do whatever you want to. And do whatever you want to. I will make room. I will make room for you. Do whatever you want. Do whatever you want to. Come do whatever you want to. Yeah, here's where I lay it down. Here is where I lay it down. Every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. And this is my surrender here. Here is where I lay it down. Every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. All honor. Oh, his spirit is so thick. All glory to you, and all honor, and all glory, all power to you, all honor, all tradition, break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Oh, your way is better. Oh, shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Oh, your way is better. Do whatever you want to. Yeah, we'll make room for you. Come do whatever you want to. Do whatever you want to. Oh, come and move. We're ready for you. We're ready for you. We're ready for you. Do what you want to do. We're ready for you. Ready for you. Spirit, please on us. Spirit, breathe on us. Breathe on us. Breathe on us. Sing, breathe on me. 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 Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Oh, your way is better. Yeshua.
There's a theme tonight. I feel like the Lord's told me this before. Better than any sermon, if the Lord says, just say his name. We could just say Jesus. And it'd be the most incredible service. If that's what the Lord is wanting us to do. And I'm hearing the Lord wanting his children to call on him. Jesus. Yeshua. Jesus.
Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Say my Jesus. My Jesus, my Jesus,
my Jesus,
my
Jesus, my Jesus,
my comfort, my shelter, my Jesus,
my Jesus, my Jesus.
The name of the Lord is a strong tower, mighty refuge. All who run into it shall be saved.
My Jesus.
That's what we're going to be talking about tonight.
My Jesus.
Who is your refuge?
My Jesus.
Run into Jesus. The loving arms. More than just a savior. More than our redeemer. He is those things. He is our Father in heaven. Holy is the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.
My beloved is the most beautiful among thousands and thousands. My beloved is the most beautiful among thousands and thousands. Yeshua. Voice, but 0% instruments. My beloved is the most beautiful among thousands and thousands. My beloved is the most beautiful among thousands and thousands. Yeshua,
Lord's telling me there's someone in this room that's saying they're actually getting attacked. They don't realize they're getting attacked. They think it's their own thoughts. This is all fake. I don't feel a thing. You're in danger of shutting your heart off. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I promise you, if you call on the name of the Lord right now, and we're all going to sing one more time, nobody even is paying attention or looking around to find out who that one is. Religious spirits want to hear, who is that one? No, no, no. We're all going to sing the name of the Lord. Every eye closed, focused on the Lord, focused on the Lord. He's all that matters. He's all that matters. He's all that matters. One more time.
Yeshua. We're lost within your arms. We're lost within your gaze. We're drowning in your love. We're lost within your embrace. We're found within your gaze. We're found within your love. We're found within your mercy, drowning in your grace. Oh, shake up the ground, all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better.
Recommit yourself to the Lord with this song.
Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the wall of all my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better. I will make room for you.
Yes. Make room. Oh, he's in the room. The Lord weeps when we reject him. There's so many in this world that are rejecting him. I can't can't even imagine if one of my kids, it breaks my heart when my two-year-old, she doesn't know what she's doing, when I say, do you love me? And she's having a temper tantrum, and she's like, no. Like, I know she doesn't mean it, because then, like, 5 minutes later, she's like, I love you. But it breaks my heart in that second that that happens. Imagine that times 7 billion. We can't even fathom what that feels like. God, we accept you in this room. We honor you in this room. You are welcome in this place. This is your house. Rabashata. Let's continue to just say his name. Worship him in your way, own way for about a minute.
It's your breath, Yeshua,
Jesus. Father God, we never want to stifle your Holy Spirit in this house. I want to release this teaching that you've given me, Lord, but I just feel the Holy Spirit's wanting me to prophesy over a couple people. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yara bokora bash. Rete bari yara bato kota bashi. The Lord's wanting to remind you that the devil has been attacking you so hard with sickness is because he's given you the Lord has given you a healing ministry. And the Lord, it's time for you to start walking in the fullness of that. Thank you, Lord. So I'm going to lay hands on you. Father God, we thank you for the release. You've been waiting on someone to tell you it's time to go, and the Lord is the one that tells you it's time to go. It's time to go. It's go time. Your ministry, the devil's been attacking it for the past 35 years. Thank you, Lord. I see a divine turnaround. For you.
both of y'all, because y'all are one. I see a divine turnaround. Those teaching, I got these ribbons here, that teaching gift and those doors are already starting to open. It's not about the gifts, it's about what God wants to do in each and every situation. Hallelujah. I know you were wanting to speak tonight, but the Lord told me you're going to be speaking next week. Both of y'all, because they had the Lord saved their life this week. They're going to talk about it a little bit next week. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Kushakata bukamba yete batu. Rebata bushiata bukuteba yete batu brepa papa ye rebari arabashu. I don't know which one of it, but I felt like the Lord was saying there's going to be a 30% increase. It's you. The Lord's telling me there's going to be a 30% increase in finances for you. And he's going to be doing this new thing. In the next 3 to 4 months, you're going to see a financial blessing and an increase on top of that. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The Lord has seen also what you've sown in secret. You're not one that boasts or brags about it, but the Lord's seen you sowing time, you sowing finances. Especially you're a good steward of the time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord's got some people. This is going to be crazy for you. He's got one or two people he's wanting to bring into your life. I believe it's going to come one at first and then another. And you're actually going to be mentoring them. So I know that's not what you want to do. Sorry. Is anybody ever ready? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That teaching gift on your life is going to really start. Because you're one that hits the books. You hit the books. The Lord, I think I gave you this word about a year ago or so. The Lord's also wanting to grow you in the area of evangelism. You've been praying about prophecy because it intrigues you, but at the same time, it freaks you out. And the Lord says, not yet on that. He's wanting to grow you in the areas that he wants to grow you in. He's wanting to establish you in one thing before you move on to the next thing. Amen? The next thing is evangelism for you. But that teaching gift is going to start coming around to where you're going to be blessing other people with it. Praise the Lord. Go for it.
You know, the Holy Spirit just put on my heart. This is just a real simple and short thing, but a lot of people, they raise their faith up when there's more people in the room. And I just wanted to say that the scripture says where two or three are gathered there in my name, there I am in the midst of them. And I want you to take that to heart, please, and never think again and limit God what he can do because of the number of people.
It's never been about numbers anyway, right? Think of Gideon. God sends them away when they're not ready. The Lord told this. This is not an arrogant statement. The Lord told me this about our ministry, that we are a mountaintop ministry. The air gets thin the higher up you go. I don't care if two people come. It doesn't bolster my spirit when I see 50 or 60, unless they're hungry. If they're not hungry, they're not going to receive anyway. God, we thank you for bringing hungry people that are desiring to be fed. Jesus, you said this. I'm going to echo those words. You who are hungry, come. You who are thirsty, come. The Holy Spirit is the living water. Jesus is the living water that we can drink freely from. Hallelujah. We were going to do the Aaronic blessing. We're going to save that for next week. Praise the Lord. Let's go before the Lord in prayer before we do this teaching. The Lord had a little bit of a prophetic word at the end. It's just kind of a rhema word for the body of Christ. But first, we're going to delve into this teaching. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You can have a seat, bro. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, we thank you for gracing us with your word. God, that we are worshipers of you in spirit and in truth. And the truth is the divine inspiration of Scripture, the Logos paired with the Rhema, the spoken word and the written word. God, we thank you that you're bringing the body into a divine unison, a oneness with you. Thank you, Lord. God, that the true ones are going to be partnered together in you, in spirit and in truth, in love. God, if you told us to, we'd forsake all others for you, Lord. God, we want to be that hungry for you. As long as we know it's you, Lord, here we are. Send us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, I got requested. I've taught on the armor of God a few times. I got requested specifically to do the armor of God, and honestly, I wasn't really feeling it. I was like, okay, well, I've had a few people prophesy things about what my armor looked like, and I felt led to kind of share that, but I'll do that probably towards the end. I first want to delve into the word. So I got the Amplified pulled up, but it's if y'all want to turn with me, if y'all have your Bibles, your phones, Ephesians 6, verse 10. And actually, is Vash, if you want to pull it up on the screen for us, the scriptures, Ephesians 6, verse 10. And we actually had a pretty instant confirmation, too. Sarah, were you with Emma? Y'all were driving behind an armor pest control truck right after I told her that we're going to be teaching on the armor of God. So I love the Amplified. It really breaks down a lot of times both what the Hebrew, the Aramaic, and the Greek kind of helps break that down without having to turn directly into a Strong's or Concordance. So Ephesians 6, starting at verse 10. Be strong in the Lord. Draw your strength from him and be empowered through your union with him and in the power of his boundless might. Now I'm going to be pausing to kind of break down what some of these words mean. This word for might here is kratos. There are several different words in the Greek that mean power. Greek is a very exact or concise language, quite unlike the Hebrew, which is more of a fluid, kind of artistic kind of style. I love how the Lord, I've heard some people teach, and to me it's a little off, that basically the whole Bible should be read from a Hebraic kind of understanding. And I kind of see what they're saying because the writers of it were Jews. But I believe God is a very exact, purposeful God. Amen? In that it's a marriage of the Hebrew and the Greek. Can God not protect his own word? So God, who's a God of exactitudes, he purposefully meant for the beginning of the Bible to be Hebrew, married with the Greek, okay? Think of a Greek mindset as more of one that's like logic and reason, kind of like how a lot of us are trained in the Western Hemisphere, whereas the Hebrew is more of the art, kind of right side of the brain. We need that balance between both, amen? The Bible, the main words for power in the Bible, there's several, but the main three are exousia, Y'all probably heard that. Any Bible scholars in the room? Exousia refers to authority or authoritative power. And the other is dunamis, which is explosive power. It's where we get the word dynamite. And this word here, again, is kratos, which primarily means more of like a dominion. So in this context, it refers to dominant strength or power. So put on the full armor of God, for his precepts are like the splendid armor of a heavily armed soldier. Another Greek word here that's worth looking at is, I might butcher these, panoplia, which is complete armor. A full set of defensive and offensive, everything needed to wage war, a successful warfare. And figuratively, this refers to the full resources the Lord gives to the believer so they can successfully wage war. In this way, we do not fight for victory, but from his victory. Amen. So that you may be able to successfully stand up against all the schemes and all the strategies and the deceits of the devil. In verse 12, there are more than a few terms that could be just nomenclature here, but we need to delve into what each word here truly means. More than likely, Paul is suggesting here a type of demonic hierarchy of sorts as follows. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. We don't fight a physical battle as Christians, contending only with physical opponents, but against the rulers or kings, against the powers, and that's the word exousia, the authorities, the authoritative powers that we earlier discussed, against the world forces. This is a Greek word, cosmocrator. It's two words combined, merged. Cosmos, where we get cosmos. It's Latin or Greek. Literally means universe, or figuratively, worldly. Kind of like how when the Bible says flesh, it's not referring to our flesh. It's referring to mainly to our fleshly nature, usually. And kratos, again, which is the diminutive might. So in this context, it refers to ungodly demonic rulers of this world. That's according to Strong's lexicon. So they're of this world, and they're asserting their independence of God. It's used of the demonic powers controlling the sublunary world and of this present darkness against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly or spiritually supernatural places. Therefore, here we go. Therefore, put on the complete armor of God so that you will be able to successfully resist and stand your ground in the evil day of danger. And having done everything that the crisis demands to stand firm, and that is in your place, fully prepared, immovable, and victorious. I love the Amplified. So stand firm and hold your ground, having tightened the wide band of truth, which is personal integrity and moral courage around your waist. This is actually a Hebrew idiom. So it literally says here, where it says tighten the band of truth, it actually says gird your loins, which is a common phrase. It's found often in the Bible. In the Hebraic culture at the time, this is an urgent call to get ready for immediate action or a coming event. The phrase is related to the type of clothing worn in ancient times, robes. Before any vigorous activity, the loose ends of the clothing, the tunics, cloaks, mantles, etc., had to be gathered up and tucked into a wide band worn about the midsection of the body. The band is usually about 6 inches wide. Also served as a kind of pocket or pouch to carry personal items such as a dagger, money, or other necessities. Gird up your mind or gird up your heart are examples or variants of this phrase and call for mental or spiritual preparation for a coming challenge. Y'all remember when the prophet Elijah girded up his loins and outran chariots? Because the Holy Spirit had to be on him for that if you're out running horses.
and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, which is an upright heart, and having strapped on your feet the gospel of peace. And this word here is the Greek equivalent to the Hebrew word shalom, meaning perfect peace. In preparation to face the enemy with firm-footed stability and readiness produced by the good news. And this is a reference to Roman soldiers' shoes, which were studded with hobnails to give them stability on the battlefield. So if you're getting pushed back, you're firmly putting that nail in the ground like cleats, and you're not going anywhere. I want to also quickly reference here Jesus during his Sermon on the Mount or the Olivet Discourse when he said, "Blessed are the peacemakers." The Holy Spirit wanted me to touch on this. Blessed are the peacemakers. Through God and God alone can perfect peace be made or established. I would also like to point out Jesus did not say peace keepers, which is an often misquote. He said peace makers. Not going to argue semantics here. The Holy Scripture says what it says. We are at war with a very real enemy, and do not take what I'm saying here out of context either. Remember, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. I'm not talking about pulling out a Colt peacemaker. I want to be crystal clear. This is a spiritual fight, not one of natural descent. Amen. Now back to the text. Above all, lift up the protective shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one, the devil. Here, I know we're touching on a lot of Greek, so stay with me. Here, the Greek word refers to a large Roman soldier's shield designed to protect the entire body. It had an iron frame and was covered with several layers of leather. When soaked with water before a battle, the shield could put out fiery missiles that were thrown at them by the enemy. We're going to talk about that a little bit more later. Arrows, also having a spiritual meaning in God's word. Psalms 127, 4 through 5 says, "Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth. How blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them." Praise the Lord. We're going to launch every one of our kids at the devil. Get them full of the Holy Ghost and then go kick the devil's butt. And take the helmet of salvation. And 1 Thessalonians 5:8 also says, "We belong to the day. Let us be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love and the helmet of our hope of salvation." There's many references to this armor. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, this refers to Scripture. It's not specifically referring to praying in the Holy Spirit here. Jesus didn't pray in the Spirit at the devil in the wilderness. He declared, "It is written." I believe in praying in the Spirit. Y'all heard me doing it earlier. But this is referring to the Logos, which can become a rhema when you speak it out loud. If it's a now word, when the devil comes and misquotes Scripture at you, you have to know Scripture. He'll twist it to no end at you. When the Lord, I'm going to give you an example. The Lord told me, I'm working now, but the Lord told me, quit your job last year. And I had not only the devil in my head whispering to me, if you don't work, you're not going to eat. The Bible says that. But I had people that I knew and loved telling me the same thing, calling me a bum and all kinds of stuff. I'm like, I'm doing what the Lord told me to do. If you're doing what the Lord's telling you to do, you're in the Lord's will. Amen. So you just got to test the Spirit and know that it's the Lord that spoke that to you. Hallelujah. I like, he just spoke for a few minutes, but Apostle Keith came in a month ago or so, and he's like, "Jesus didn't roshakatabashi the devil." I love it. He said, "It is written." I actually heard, and I believe he's a man of God, I won't say who it is, but he's a prolific speaker. He said, I heard a teaching once, and it was completely off. It was an error, big time. He said, ignore the devil. Treat him like a kid in a schoolyard and just ignore him. And, you know, just he'll go away. He gets annoyed when you ignore him. okay, I see what you're saying there, but Jesus didn't do that. That settles the matter for me. I'm not going to ignore the devil. I'm going to acknowledge he's there. I'm not going to bring him any glory, but I'm going to tell him what's what. I'm going to talk to him like a dog, because that's what he is. He's a dog. Can somebody grab me a Kleenex? I'm sorry. I got allergies and the Holy Spirit making my nose run. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We're healed in Jesus' name. Thank you. All right. Thank you, Jesus. So, verse 18. With all prayer and petition, pray with specific requests at all times, on every occasion, and in every season, in the Spirit. That's referring to praying in the Spirit. And with this in view, stay alert with all perseverance and petition, interceding in prayer for all God's people, and pray for me. That's Apostle Paul talking, but also pray for me, please. That words may be given to me when I open my mouth, and to proclaim boldly the mystery of the good news of salvation, for which I am an ambassador in chains, and pray that in proclaiming it, I may speak boldly and courageously as I should. Okay, I know we've given that's a lot of jam-packed information, but there's a lot more, so buckle up. I don't want to overload anyone, but would also like to touch on a couple different ancient battle formations. So, in Greece, back when it was the dominant world power around the time of Alexander the Great, there was a military formation that the Greek army called does anybody know? The phalanx. Yes. I love ancient warfare. It's, to me, I don't really care for guns. We used to sword fight as kids. And this phalanx, which consisted mainly of hoplites, which were Greek light infantry, they would lock their shields in a close form in deep ranks together and move and be as one. They usually strapped on like a buckler type of shield and a elongated spear. And they wore very light armor. They were light infantry. Is that speaking to anybody? This is one of the ways we need to be moving as one with our shields of faith locked together. Later on, during the time of the Roman rule, they, being inspired by the Greeks, improved upon the formation and made it their own. They increased the sizes of their shields. The Roman legionaries had equipped not a buckler, but a much larger oblong shield, which they called, if I'm saying this right, Dad took some Latin, scutum. Scutum? Doesn't matter. The shields usually had large eagle wings painted on them too, but that's neither here nor there. I just like eagles. They called this formation the testudo formation. Does anybody know what that means? Turtle or tortoise. The shield size was not the only improvement, but the way they maneuvered and carried themselves also set this formation apart from the earlier phalanx. Not only did they lock their shields together in front, but in the testudo or tortoise formation, the back rows held their shields over their head, locking them in place, shielding them from projectiles. Essentially, they became a walking tank. Who wants to be a walking tank when the devil's attacking? This armor is spiritual armor. I attended a church, won't say the name of the church, where they would religiously teach, I put on the armor of God every day. Sounds good. And they would go through every piece of armor. I put on the helmet of salvation. We're talking about adults, not teaching kids. This is adults would do this. That isn't what Paul is talking about. We need to put it on, and how about we never take it off? It's spiritual armor. There's no reason to take it off. It isn't heavy. It's light. No pun intended. Why in the world would you remove it? You can sleep in this armor. Trust me. Now, the book of Ephesians may be the most notable place in Scripture that we find the full armor of God, but according to the rule of first mention, for the record, I don't practice the science of hermeneutics. However, this concept does carry some value. Broken down, this rule basically states that to delve deeper into what the Bible is saying about a particular subject matter, you must find where it is first mentioned in the Word. In this case, Isaiah 59:17 first mentions similar armor, if y'all want to turn there. I'm not sure if we're going to read the whole thing or not, but Isaiah 59:17. I'll give y'all a second to turn there. It's on the screen. But I'm going to read out of the Amplified again. For he, and this is referring to the Lord, puts on righteousness like a coat of armor. Look, let me read that one. I'm going to read that again. For he, the Lord, puts on righteousness like a coat of armor. Like a coat of armor. And salvation like a helmet on his head. I'm sorry. He put on garments of vengeance for clothing and covered himself with zeal and great love for his people as a cloak. This is not physical armor. This is spiritual, and it has a very figurative, metaphorical context. We need to get that straight. So when the Bible says put on the helmet of salvation, God's trying to paint a picture that we need to know beyond the shadow of a doubt we are saved. Okay? When we put on the breastplate of righteousness, it's not something I just get up and say, I put on the breastplate of righteousness. It's being righteous and righteous living. And the word says, be holy as I am holy. It's time for holiness to come back to the church. We need to quit tagging holiness as a religious spirit. There's been so many times people have said, you have a religious spirit because you're wearing a suit. And I'm like, I hate to tell you, you have a religious spirit because you prejudged me. That's what a religious spirit is. Let's get it right. I might get back to Isaiah 59, but the Lord told me to talk about a couple prophetic words. I had a great word this morning. I believe in the word of prophecy as long as it lines up with what the Lord is already telling you. Hallelujah. It's got to also line up with the word of God. Hallelujah. First, I'll talk about the one this morning. This morning, I had we went to see Prophet Abner Suarez at Father's House this weekend. He had a little conference event. It was pretty cool. He's given me words in the past that were really good. Previous words like, other preachers see you as a bull in a china shop, and you're not that way. I'm like, wow, that's dead on. Most people think I'm some kind of like demon. I'm talking about spiritual leaders think that about me. And then I go pray about it, and I go, God, is that right? What they're saying? Are they saying, like, when they say I'm in pride, am I in pride? And the Lord said, no, you wouldn't even be asking me if you were. Okay, so what's going on there? They're in pride. I had somebody prophesy. I've had this prophesied over me, and the Lord spoke this to me about 3-4 years ago. And then I had other people confirm it. Then a friend of mine that passed, he passed away, but I'm going to paraphrase the prophecy. He said, your armor is so gleaming white and righteous. Your shield is like a mirror. The Lord's showing me your armor, and it's dazzling light. And people, when they see you in this armor, they're seeing themselves. So when they're speaking these curses over you, all they're seeing is themselves, reflections of themselves. And I'm like, cool. So we network with a lot of different ministries, and I don't want to speak ill of any one of them because a lot of them are my brothers and I love them, but a lot of times the devil will whisper in our ear, and we have a choice. We have to recognize that that's the devil, or we listen to it. and think it's discernment and think it's the Holy Ghost. I've had spiritual leaders call me immature to my face, and I'm like, bless you to your face. How about that? And I don't say it sarcastically. I smile at them, and I show them the love of Christ. The thing about the devil, his accusations are baseless, rooted in nothing. When somebody makes an accusation against you, thinking it's a correction, there's going to be no evidence of this. So when I ask them to provide me evidence, they go, we just feel that way about you. Or that's what the Lord showed me. I'm like, I think it sounds like you just said the devil is your Lord. I'm not trying to compare myself to Jesus. I'm not perfect. But if they called Jesus demoniac and a demoniac, they said he was not just demon-possessed, but they called him Beelzebub, the Lord of the Flies, the Prince of Demons. They attributed that to the Savior, and Jesus promised us the same persecution. He promised it to us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We need to be armored up in this time. The shield of faith needs to not just be a buckler. In fact, I heard a good teaching on Psalms 91. The Lord is a shield and a buckler. It says that in Scripture. It's both. He's both. A shield, I picture more of the Roman legionary shield, large shield, or a kite shield. The Lord's had me speak a lot of prophetic words over people regarding their armor, and I've seen all kinds of cool stuff, visions and stuff for people. But we need to do a self-evaluation with the Lord and allow him to evaluate us. Because, you know, as much as I like the prophetic word, I'd rather hang out with God in the secret place and have him speak stuff over me. Because we all have that capability of hearing from the Lord ourselves. This is the new covenant. We don't rely on an Old Testament prophet bringing us the word of the Lord. Should only confirm. Sometimes there's times where a prophetic word goes beyond the confirmation and it speaks new life and things. I'm not referring to that here. For example, I'm not sure if the Lord spoke to you already about financial increase. Probably not. These are things that are bound to determine. And also, there's two quick teachings on the prophetic word of the Lord. So first off, sometimes when the Lord speaks a word to us, we can sometimes put it on the back burner and it'll come to pass. But sometimes there's stuff that we have to do. God, I got a word. I need you to unpack that. What does it look like? Was it really from you? Is there anything you need me to do? Sometimes the Lord will say, just rest in it. It's whatever he tells you to do specifically with that word. We're supposed to steward the word of the Lord. You say, well, I've heard people also say, well, if the Lord said it, it's just going to happen. Not necessarily true. Did the Lord pronounce judgment over Nineveh? And did judgment happen? No. So, without context, Jonah would be a false prophet. The word of the Lord was, repent or else judgment will proceed. Okay? Proof of what I just said in context. Sometimes there's things we have to do to either avoid the word if it's a correction or if the Lord says, hey, he wants you to go to Zimbabwe and of course you got to test it, but we're like, nope, not going to happen. The Lord isn't just going to pick you up and just put you in Zimbabwe. We have free will, right? Y'all understand what I'm saying? Gosh, I've gotten so many debates with religious spirits about prophetic stuff. God reveals to his servants, the prophets, his ideal will, and we can say no to it. Okay? Hallelujah. All right, do y'all want to read Isaiah, the whole 15, chapter 59? All right, I'm gonna go through this quickly, and then I'm gonna get to this word the Lord has for me, for us. Isaiah 59, verse 1. Behold, the Lord's hand is not so short that it cannot save, nor his ear so impaired that it cannot hear. But your wickedness has separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with wickedness, with sin, with injustice, and wrongdoing. Your lips have spoken lies. Your tongue mutters wickedness. No one sues righteously, but for the sake of doing injury to others, to take some undue advantage. And no one pleads his case in truth, but rather they trust in empty arguments and speak lies. They conceive trouble and bring forth injustice. They hatch viper's eggs. That sounds like a religious spirit. And weave spider's webs. That's what a Jezebel spirit does. Lies, lies, lies. He who eats of their eggs dies. And from an egg which is crushed, a viper breaks out. Their webs will not serve as clothing, nor will they cover themselves with what they make. Their works are works of wickedness, and the act of violence is in their hands. Their feet run to evil, and they rush to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are thoughts of wickedness. Devastation and destruction are their highways. They do not know the ways of peace. There is no justice in their tracks. This is sounding more and more like America or the world. They have made them into crooked paths. Whoever walks on them does not know peace. Therefore, justice is far from us, and righteousness does not overtake us. And we expectantly hope for light, but only see darkness. We hope for a gleam of light, but we walk in darkness and gloom. We grope for a wall like the blind. We grope for like those who have no eyes. We stumble at midday as in the twilight. Among those who are healthy, we are like dead men. We all groan and growl like bears and coo like sad doves. gotta love the Hebrew. It's great. We hope for justice, but there is none. For salvation, but it is far from us. For our transgressions are multiplied before you, O Lord, and our sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and we know and recognize our wickedness, rebelling against and denying the Lord, turning away from following our God, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving and muttering from the heart lying words. Justice is pushed back, and righteous behavior stands far away. For the truth has fallen in the city square, and integrity cannot enter. Yes, truth is missing. It's missing today, isn't it? And he who turns away from evil makes himself a prey. Now the Lord saw it, and it displeased him that there is no justice. He saw that there was no man, and he was amazed that there was no one to intercede on behalf of truth and right. Therefore, his own arm brought salvation to him. The word for salvation here is also Yasha. And Jesus' name is Yeshua, which actually means God's salvation, salvation from Yah. And his own righteousness sustained him. For he, the Lord, verse we just read, put on righteousness like a coat of armor, and salvation like a helmet on his head. He put on garments of vengeance for clothing and covered himself with zeal and great love for his people as a cloak. As their deeds deserve, so he will repay wrath to his adversaries, retribution to his enemies. To the islands and coastlands he will repay, for they will fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun. And he will come in like a narrow rushing stream with the breath of the Lord, which overwhelms the enemy. A redeemer, Messiah, will come to Zion and to those in Israel who turn from transgression or sin, declares the Lord. Hallelujah. As for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. my spirit which is upon you, writing the law of God on the heart, and my words which I have put in your mouth shall not depart from your mouth. Come on, there's good news. Nor from the mouths of your true spiritual children, nor from the mouth of your children's children, says the Lord, from now and forever. Wow. Wow. Praise the Lord. So what does all this teach us? To me, when I read this chapter out of the book of Isaiah, the primary thing it tells me is that when things look bleak, when darkness looks like it's about to prevail, that's when salvation comes. That's when Jesus shows up. Jesus here is donned in the armor of God. He is robed in the righteousness of the Lord Yahweh. So back to the book of Ephesians, Paul tells us to put on the same type of armor. What is he communicating to us? What I hear him saying is that we can put on God's very own armor. It is the armor of the Most High God. It's a revelation, even though it's called the armor of God. It's God's very own armor. We are his kids, after all. When we acknowledge Jesus, the Messiah, as our Savior King, then we can put on the very same armor that he wears. Hallelujah. Essentially, we are putting on Jesus. It is the very same Holy Spirit that resides in us to empower and enable us to live righteously, not through our own merits. We are called by to be holy, just as I said, as he is holy. We are called to fully surrender to God. If we are baptized by and indwelt by the dunamis, dynamite power of the Holy Spirit, we have the very word of God that is greater than any teacher. We are without excuse when we come to the fullness of the knowledge of the truth of God's word. That's what God's word also tells us. So I heard the Lord kind of speak this to me as I was reading it. Excuse me one second. I want to be very clear here. God does not take pleasure in the death of the wicked. That broke God's heart, what she said tonight. It hurt me. I know it hurt God. Know if y'all overheard, not trying to embarrass anybody. I know she's not here, but basically she's filled with demons, and she made a choice to, she wants the demons. It's sad. It's very sad. So we're going to pray for her at the end too. That she wakes up. The Lord says, do I take any pleasure in the death of the wicked? Wouldn't I prefer, says God, that he turn from his ways and live? For I take no pleasure in anyone's death, declares the Lord God. So repent and live. Just as the Lord declared to the prophet Ezekiel, we need to repent. That is, turn our attention fully to God, submit to him, and in all of our ways acknowledge Jesus Christ as our Lord. We cannot have true revival. I'm going to repeat that. We cannot have true revival. And I'm not dogging any of the revivals going on. Those are great. I praise the Lord. I'm talking about what the Lord told me for this area. We cannot have true revival without the cultivation of real repentance. The very fruit of repentance is revival. They are synonymous. They go hand in hand. You cannot have one without the other. If there was no need of repentance, then there would be no need of revival. Is that making any sense? We don't want to just religiously go through the motions. This is a marriage covenant. A marriage will die if it does not have romance. That's a word. A marriage will die if it does not have romance. This word to us, the word of God to us, is a love letter. It's a love letter from the Most High God, the one who created everything, spoke it into existence, spoke every good thing into existence, wants a relationship with us. Do we really get that? We are to enter into his divine romance. This word is an invitation from the Father to his children to the marriage covenant. There is a wedding feast, just as we talked about last week with Apostle Yohanan. There is a wedding feast that has been laid out and prepared for us. There's gifts that have been laid out and prepared for us. Leah, if I can invite you back up to play for us. Sarah, if you don't mind going, and we're going to take communion tonight. The Lord just filled me in on that. You don't mind going and getting the communion cups from the back? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Rashokarabati. Rebareando kurebashi kite atura bashata. Jesus, Jesus. Has there ever been a name so sweet as Jesus?
Spirit like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Jesus, I love you. I love you.
Jesus.
Jesus,
the holy and anointed one.
Holy and anointed one. Risen and exalted one, Jesus, your name is like a honey on my lips, your spirit like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp unto my path. Jesus, I love you. I love you. To worship you, I live. To worship you, I live to worship you.
Let's sing We Worship.
Oh, Jesus. To worship you, we live. To worship you, we live. To worship you, we live. We live to worship you. Oh, to worship. And to worship you we live. To worship you we live. We live to worship you.
Oh,
worship you, we live.
Jesus.
Oh, to worship you, we live.
Jesus.
To worship you, we live. We live to worship you. To worship you we live, to worship you we live to worship you. Oh, yeah.
Hallelujah.
I'm gonna say something that the Lord's telling me to say. You don't hear it before many communions. Normally you hear what Jesus said when he broke the bread. The Lord's telling me to say what he said before. Before that. If he said, if we do not eat of his body and drink of his blood, we're not worthy of him. People didn't like that. I believe he had 120 followers at the time when he said that. Guess how many left? All but 12. Let's say that. All but 12. And then Jesus, who normally was known for turning to the apostles and explaining, all right, here's what I meant. He didn't do that. He said to them, are you going to leave too? And that's what they responded. But Lord, your words hold life. Where else would we go? Yours are the words of the kingdom. You're the Messiah. If we can't trust you, who can we trust? They left. They left their blessing. They left the communion cup. It is a blood-forged covenant, a covenant forged in blood. In an ideal wedding, not going to be gross, but in an ideal wedding, when a man and a woman unite as one, there's a blood covenant that's cut. God prophetically is drawing us a picture of his blood covenant in this. He compares it to a marriage, a wedding. Will you partake of him? The one that looks back after putting their hand to the plow is not worthy of him. This is symbolic. It has great meaning. Most churches won't go into the depth of the meaning behind. His blood is healing. His blood is an atonement for our sins. without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. It's not just 10 steps to a better person. That's religion. It is washed. I want to be washed clean. Declare it to the Lord if that's what you want. I want to be washed clean. I'm tired. I used to have demons in me. It's been a long time, don't worry. This preacher's got demons. No, I had, past tense, demons in me. I used to beat up guys 2 or 3 times my size. Get in fights at the drop of a hat. Demons have some power. There is no power like God's power. There is no power like God's power. I've seen people full of demons get delivered from a touch, from a word, from a hug, from a song. I've seen all kinds of crazy stuff. We were probably one of the craziest things I've seen as far as deliverances is a team of us went downtown a few years ago, and man, we prayed a 50-foot perimeter of angels around us, and man, people were falling out. We were walking into places, and people were falling out around us. This guy, this drug dealer, I didn't know he was a drug dealer at the time. This lady comes crying. She's like, pray for my son, pray. And I was like, all right, lady, we'll pray for your son. We went close to him, and he went like, ugh, and his eyes rolled back in his head. And one of our girls in our group said, he's got a gun, he's got a gun, and started freaking out. And I heard it, but I was in the spirit. I was just like, whatever, we got angels. Laid hands on the guy, and a couple others came up behind him. I started prophesying over him, praying for him. What the Lord told me to say, the Lord started highlighting, bing, bing, bing. Up in your apartment, there's drugs in 3 different locations hidden. The Lord's telling you to dispose of it now. We prayed out. We cast Leviathan out of him, Python out of him. His eyes went sideways like a blowfish. It was the craziest thing. And he just looked at me and said, yes, sir. And he got up and ran upstairs. And I was like, we're not going to see him tonight. He's gone. He came back down and he said, what did y'all do to me? He was hungry for Jesus after that. His mom's in the background freaking out. He doesn't have a gun. He didn't have a gun. He doesn't have a gun. Like, clearly, he had a gun. None of that matters. My mom had a friend that was in a mugging, and the lady said, stop in the name of Jesus. And the guy's sitting there with a gun like, lady, what'd you do to me? Can't move. Can't move. And then they're just like walking away. Don't leave me like this, lady. In Jesus' name, you can move, when they were a safe distance. And then he's like, ah, and he ran away. They can't do anything. None of that had anything to do with communion. Hallelujah. Leo, do you mind leading us in communion? Because apparently I don't know how.
We love you, brother. As we eat this, I want us to remember those words. This is truly, you know, I know there's doctrinal, you know, differences and whatnot, but, you know, Jesus said, this is my body, which is broken for you. So whatever your beliefs are about that, I want us to just value this for a moment and just realize how precious this bread is, that he gave us his body in order that we could truly be saved. And that salvation is complete. It's a deliverance of healing. That he has, just as he enjoys his resurrected body, we may partake in that resurrected and whole body. Bible says that we were buried with him through baptism and raised with him in fullness of life. Been buried with him through baptism and raised again. Amen. So that means that we are participants in the resurrected power, love, glory of God, only by his grace and only by his blood and his mercy. So as we take this bread together, let's break it first. I know it's a small wafer, but just as his body was broken, Lord, we thank you for breaking your body for us, and we give you thanks for the breaking of your body and for the provision, Father. We give you thanks for the provision of your Son, who is the bread of heaven, given for the life of the world. And so as we take this, we receive the life that you have given to us as a gift. Hallelujah. Whoever believes in him, John 3:16, whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Today you hold everlasting life in your hands. We have it in our hearts as well, but we hold everlasting life in our hands. And as we take this, we take your life into ourselves, and we offer ourselves in exchange. In reverence and in thanks. Today, as you take this, we declare healing over your bodies. In Jesus' name. Let's partake of the bread together. The Bible says that he is our peace, who has broken down the dividing wall between us and the Father. So, Father, through the blood, we now come freely into your presence, into the Holy of Holies, where we may worship you without shame, without regret, without fear, having our sins washed away. We boldly approach the throne and we partake now in the suffering of Christ in order that we may also share in his glory. This cup of blood is a cup of suffering, and it is also a cup of covenant, and it is also a cup of joy. And today, as we take this cup, we honor the one. We honor the one who gave his blood, his very life blood, as a propitiation for our sins. And we thank him for it in Jesus' name. Partake of the cup. Thank you for breaking the bread of your body, spilling the wine of your blood. Hearts will sing forever. Thank you for breaking the bread of your body, spilling the wine of your blood. Thank you. Our hearts will sing forever.
Words offhand, but I felt like the Lord's just wanting to hear his children sing to him. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves me.
Jesus loves me.
Hallelujah.
This I know, for the Bible tells me.
the kids in here? Strong. I can get them.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Hallelujah. Once more with the kids in here.
Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
It's really that simple. The Bible says it. That's the way it is. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, we belong to him. They are weak, we're weak. He is strong. Yes.
Yes.
Jesus loves me. The love of God is in this room. Yes.
Jesus loves me.
We receive your love.
Yes. Jesus loves me.
Jesus, have your way in this place. Holy Spirit, breathe new life on us. As the coming days grow darker, God, may your light shine all the brighter in us. What good is salt if it's lost its saltiness? Kurabashando. Hallelujah. We're going to officially dismiss. If you want to hang out with the Lord a little bit longer, fellowship, whatever the Lord leads you to do. Praise God.